So in this video, we are going to start with the nervous system. The nervous system is a network of nerve fibers and cells that acts as the post office of your body. It transmits the messages from one part of your body to another in seconds. There are two types of cells that are present in the nervous system. The first type is the neuron, and the second is the neuroglial cells, also known as the glial cells. The neurons are the basic units that actually receive the nerve impulses and transmit them to the next neuron or the receptor organ. The neuroglial cells, on the other hand, act like the mother of the neurons. They help in the nourishment and all the things that are to be transmuted or exchanged between the neuron and the different parts of our body. The neuroglial cells also hold the neurons in place, and they also make the myelin sheath of the neurons. What exactly is a myelin sheath? We'll understand that when we know the structure of neurons. In the nervous system, a neuron is present in much lesser number than the glial cells. And a neuron can be divided into three different parts. The first one are the dendrites that actually receive the nerve impulse. The second is the cell body, stoma or perikarion, which consists of all the organelles and the nucleus of the neuron. Thirdly, there is axon. Axon is the region from which nerve impulse is transmitted from one neuron to the other, or a muscle or any receptor organ. In this diagram, these sort of hair-like structures here are the dendrites. This region forms the cell body, and this entire portion is the axon of this neuron. Now, inside the cell body of this neuron, there will be some important organelles present, like firstly the nucleus, some endoplasmic reticulum, and the powerhouses of the cell, mitochondria. And other than these organelles, there are some specific structures that are seen in the neuron. Firstly, you'll observe some granules scattered in the cytoplasm. These granules are known as Nissl's granules. And these are nothing but all the ribosomes, some debris of fats and lipids, or some proteins that are present in the cytoplasm. Other than these, there are some fibers which are known as neurofibrils. Neurofibrils are the transport van within the cytoplasm. They transfer the materials from one part of this cell to another. And as we move on towards the axon, this junction that is present here, this region is the axon hillock. And the cytoplasm of this axon has a special name, that is the exoplasm. And this membrane is the exolemma. These are nothing different, but they are just given a specific name with respect to the axon. Now, coming to the end of this axon, this region here is the axon terminal, and these bulb-like structures are synaptic end bulbs. Why these are known as synaptic end bulbs is because this gap, for example, imagine there is some dendrite present here or some next neuron, right? So these gap, this gap between this axon and the dendrite of the next neuron, this gap is known as the synapse. And therefore, these bulb-like structures are the synaptic end bulbs, and this is where a neurotransmitter is stored. Now, if you remember about the electricity and physics that we studied, you might know that the charge, when it is generated at one end, is dissipated along the way, and a lot of energy is wasted. The reason why the electrical appliances heat up when we use them. What do you think will happen to the charge of a neuron that is starting from, say, your brain and is going up to either your toes? Obviously, a lot of energy will be wasted along the way. What we do to prevent this is cover this wire, or in this case, the axon, with an insulator. As you can see an example in the chargers of your phone, they are covered with a rubber insulator. So in this case, the insulator that is present is known as the myelin sheath. And the neurons that in which this myelin sheath is present are known as myelinated neurons. However, if an insulator is present from the starting to the end, there will be a loss of charge along the way. You can understand this by imagining that you are running a very long marathon. Now, you might take up all the glucose and the food and all the nutrients that you need in the beginning. But eventually, when you'll run, you'll run out of energy, right? So, what will you do? You'll carry a glucose bottle with you. And along the way, you'll drink it at different stops. These stops will give you the action potential that is needed for you to complete the next part of your run. Similarly, if there are some breaks in this myelin sheath of the axon, these will be the regions that are not insulated and therefore can regenerate all the charges that are lost, can regenerate that action potential which was received at the dendrites. So if this is your axon, the myelin sheath will be present somewhat like this. And these gaps present here are those gaps which are not insulated, and these are known as nodes of Ranvier. These cells, as I mentioned earlier, are made by the glial cells. The cells that make this myelin sheath here are known as Schwann cells. Or this would be the name that you must have seen in all your textbooks. However, these are known as Schwann cells only in the peripheral nervous system. That is everything apart from your brain and your spinal cord. In the central nervous system, they have a special name. That is oligodendrocytes. So these are known as Schwann cells in the PNS and oligodendrocytes in the central nervous system. These are the nuclei of these Schwann cells. This here is a general structure of a neuron. A neuron can obviously have different structures, and on those bases, and because of those different structures, obviously they'll have some different functions. On those bases, a neuron can be classified into various types. We are going to take that up in the next video. So if you like this explanation, do press the like button, share this video with your friends, and you'll find that subscribe button somewhere down there to subscribe for more such videos on biology. Thanks for watching.